Good morning, everybody. Good morning. It is a misty, eerie, and dense morning. And by dense, I mean the atmosphere that surrounds us here on Djuma Private Game Reserve, part of the larger Sabi Sands Game Reserve, part of the larger Greater Kruger National Park, part of the larger Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park. 3.5 million hectares of wonderful wilderness, 8 million acres. You are most welcome, and it's very good to have you along for the ride. You are watching a live game drive. Wherever you are in the world, you are being transported vicariously here to the wilds of Africa, where we're going to take you on a live dawn safari. Please talk to us if you would like to. Hashtag Safari Live if you're on the tweet, or questions at WildEarthTV as we drive around on this Sunday morning and see what the wonders of Africa have to provide us today. My name is James Hendry. On camera today we have got Andrew. Andrew is dressed in an array of sort of different colors. Today, unusually, he has exposed his face to the elements. Normally he dresses like a bank robber, but today he looks like a almost normal human being. On the other vehicle we have the irascible Brent Leo Smith, who was champing at the bit like a horse after a bucket of oats, and filming him is the diminutive Wim Droenbrach. And then in the final control room we have got Tara Dales and the red and fiery hair of Miss Kirsty McLennan Smith. You are most welcome, like I say to you. My plan today, I'm not sure if you were with us yesterday, but if you were, you will know that a buffalo met its end at the hands of, or the paws and claws, more than hands, of five male lions just over there. Now, we've been back to check the carcass, and there are no lions there. We did hear the hyenas chattering away at the carcass about probably 4 o'clock this morning, but they seem to have moved off as well. And Andrew did spot the lion tracks heading south down the road over there. Now, we did hear them calling, but quite a long way away, I think. And if, for those of you who watched the Djuma Dam cam, you would have noticed the lions around this dam during the course of the evening, calling and calling and calling, that incredibly powerful African sound of the roar of the lion. So that's the plan this morning. Just a quick note on yesterday's game drive. You will have noticed, some of you, that a few of us ended up in the dam just over there. Now, that is because we were flying a drone, which is another sort of attempt to create different content for this show. And the drone produced some very nice content before it dived headfirst into that pond. There's not a lot of water left, but the drone managed to find the only piece of water basically on Djuma, drowned itself, and is no longer functional. And that is what we were doing, trying to fish it out yesterday. I must say that I am now totally used to the feeling of catfish on my hands and feet, so I no longer make sort of unmanly squeals every time a large catfish flies into me or bites me on the leg. Okay, that is the plan this morning. We're going to head down south, see if we can find the lions again, those five big males. Maybe there'll be some other stuff, but we'll find out as we go. You're welcome. Lovely to have you along. It's a sort of warmish 15 degrees Celsius apparently, which I think is sits at about 65 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, Andrew, what I mean, so I think it's going to lift. It doesn't feel like it's going to stay for too long, though I can't see the sun coming up through it. I think it'll be a beautiful sunrise. That's KG in Australia, who managed to spot us, that hippo. Now the tracks, Andrew, seem to have already disappeared. I heard them falling so far south that I'm not going to worry too much about where the tracks are now. I think we're just going to go straight south and see what we can find. No tracks on the road at the moment. going down the road. I'm not going to try and show you the tracks now with this light so flat. We won't get some very very good definition on it on the camera, I'm afraid. Particularly easy thing to do. A bit easier on foot. But these lions move such distances that if they're not moving in an obvious place and you don't have an incredible tracking skill, to walk at the same speed that they are moving, i.e. to keep up with them, is almost impossible. I'm still on the road here. Only one. There's a Nyala. Another Nyala. So the idea is not to stop too much before we've got the sort of initial tracking out of the way, because the lions will move, and as I'm sure most of you know, they will then go fairly static for the rest of the day. So as soon as it gets vaguely warm, they will lie down under a tree and do not very much at all. But the idea is to do the sort of major tracking at this time of the early morning. While we're driving along, hoping to spot this lion, and fascinating comment from Miss Jin, thank you. Have I got all the mud out of my toenails after my excursion into the Gowrie Dam last night? Miss Jin, I will be retrieving mud from various parts of my body, I suspect, for the best part of the next month. So no, I haven't got it all out yet. We're hoping. Here anymore, Andrew. Once the road gets a bit windy, the lion may have just decided to cut straight through. There's a male leopard on the road there. We're just near where quarantine was found. His tracks are right here. See that, Andrew? Quarantine's tracks going straight down the road. So he's left the kill. I'm just going to call this in because I know there's somebody going to try and look for him. Tracks of male leopard on Twin Dams Road heading south, basically from the kill site from yesterday. I'm pretty sure it's quarantine going south down the road. These look very nice tracks. No negative looks, just the tracks. Just going to look around here. First of all, have killed fairly recently before. They have eaten most of the good stuff from that kill. And the second reason, of course, is that they're still trying to take over this territory, which means that they're not going to sit around in one place for too long. They're going to move around, roaring away and trying to establish themselves in the territory before. So, you know, and try and make sure that no other lions are able to get into the area. I'm just going to jump out of the car and have a look and see where these tracks have gone. We're going to head across to Brent and get an idea of his plan this morning, and I'll see you just now.
Good morning and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. My name is Brent Yerspeth. I'm going to be one of your guides for the next 3 hours. And we have Vim on camera. So we're in this position where quarantine was last night. We saw a little tiny bit of meat left in the tree. You can't see it from this side, but unfortunately, it looks like he has departed. And I just heard on the Game Drive channel that James has got his tracks heading south, to the south of us. So we're going to get moving and try find where he's gone. And it looks like our cat day is over and Sunday is here, and we've got to work for our animals this morning, but that's also fine. Also, for those of you who might be new, we are live with no leopards and lions right now, but hopefully we can rectify that shortly. And apart from being live, we also are interactive, so you are able to ask us questions about what we're doing out in the bush, and you can do that by emailing us on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Well, let's go see if we can find this young male leopard who's obviously finished that diker. I was wrong yesterday. I suspected it would take him to about midday to finish it. Obviously, he got hungry during the night and he has inhaled that diker. So he definitely wouldn't have gone for a drink because of the lions up towards the Djuma waterhole. Maybe he's headed for a drink towards Treehouse or Twin Downs waterhole. So let's go have a look. Road again and see what we can find. So I know James is on those tracks, so we're probably gonna try and jump ahead of James to see if that animal's gone a bit further. And of course, I would never want to be accused of stalking or following James. That's what he does to me. Oh, there's a big hole. Everyone else goes the really long way around. I've got my nice little shortcuts to different areas, and the reason I know about said shortcuts is because I've done a lot of work in this area, and that really makes a big difference when you come to off-roading, to know where and where you can't cross. And I have actually crossed in this exact spot quite a few times. Hold on, I'm gonna need a little bit of speed to ascend the sandy bank. VM, you there? Every time I tell Vim I might lose him, he just tells me to try harder. So maybe today will be the day I try hard enough. Unfortunately, our diff-lock seems not to be engaging. Sorry about the dust. Okay. We're gonna change the angle slightly. Try climb up on the harder ground where there's not as much sand. There we go. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. So guys, we're gonna be on the Game Drive channel for a second. Tracks somewhere around here. I'm just going to call him on the radio to find out exactly where. James. James, I'm on Twin Dams at the moment, just past Chelipan. Where would you like me to check? Just ahead, we can actually see James, who is following Quarantine's tracks at the moment. Should we sneak up on him and give him a bit of a fright? Well, I don't think James would get the fright. I think Andrew would get the fright, but let's change gear.
James, and as you can see, he's looking at these tracks that are running down here, and there we go.
And you can see reversing takes concentration. And we can have a look, just if we look down to the side here, there are the leopard tracks that have left what little remnants there are of that dike. There we go.
So we're not going to both drive down the same road, that would defeat the purpose of following tracks. So we're going to leave James on the tracks, and what we're going to do is we're going to go back and up another road and try leapfrog to see if it's the animal's maybe gone south or has possibly even continued further to the southwest. So we're going to head back and go on Weaver's Nest, which runs parallel to this, and obviously that's to give ourselves the best chance of finding these tracks. I'll find an animal.
Hello! Again?
Weren't you supposed to be tracking lions?
Well, they were coming down the same road.
I'm just checking. So, we've got a chance of finding both lion and leopard tracks. And
well, I'll tell you what, I'll go straight down to Twin Dam's dust bowl and see what's there.
Okay, so James is going to go straight down Twin Dams. We're going to head back up and do Weaver's Nest, which is the road that's parallel to this. And if there's nothing there, then we will head further to the east and see if that animal's gone back into the Mawati drainage.
Bye, Andrew. Thank you very much, Julia. My mother did tell me not to leave home with wet hair. I unfortunately did not listen. Listening is possibly not one of my strong points. And a lot of preemptive and early happy birthdays out there, so thanks very much, guys. My birthday's only tomorrow, but I do appreciate all the early birthday sentiment. Although you've just seen a Commander Bond standing next to the vehicle, losing lion tracks and finding our leopard tracks, we're going to cross back to him so he can give you an update on what he's doing, and that'll also give him and I a chance to speed around to the area we think the tracks might come out. So we will be back with you a little later, but go have some fun with James.
Hello everybody, welcome back to Wendy. Well, you just saw us on Jigo really, but now you're on board with Wendy. The leopard tracks have disappeared, so I'm going to leave Brent on them. The lion tracks are back on the road here. Now there are tracks of at least two of them. Going due south, I suspect unfortunately that they have disappeared south of the reserve. And we have that lovely question about why they weren't at the carcass anymore. There is a little bit of meat left, and that definitely has got something to do with the fact that they are marking territory. They're looking all the time to expand their range, and these tracks are not the tracks of a lion taking a gentle stroll. They're the tracks of what is that? It's a dike. They're the tracks of a lion on the march for territory. You can see that they're just moving in a dead straight line, and they were calling last night progressively further and further south. So unless they've decided to, for some reason, stop here at Twin Dams, which I don't think they will have,
I think we're on a fool's errand here. Go ahead. Copy that. I've got one male going south here. That's on Twin Dams. So Brent's got two others of them just down there also going south. Lots of tracks all over the place. Let's see if they cross out or if they're still within range. So an interesting one. There are five, in case perhaps you have just joined us, there are five male lions in this little coalition of, well, it's a large coalition, called the Birmingham Boys. And basically, Valerie, your question is, will they stay together? And the answer is yes, for a while. And I think once they've established themselves, they'll probably split into two and three. And that split won't be an antagonistic split. It will simply be a function of the fact that it's easier to maintain their territory if they are in a sort of split group. And that often happens with these large coalitions of lions, that they will split up into small groups and maintain. And then if there's a real challenge to their authority, then they'll come together again. They call and they come together. Well, we just need to check along the road here to see if they've crossed out. Andrew, do you see anything? Yep, there they go. Shpambile. Going in there. Okay, so I'm afraid they've gone south. So what we're going to do is a turn. That doesn't look necessarily like a big male there. Just jump out quickly and have a look. I'll try and show you. And who's it? You're not going to be able to see anything there, are you? I'll just go back a bit so that you can see. Will that work through? Yeah, that might work. Okay. Let me show you what I need.
So this is probably the best one that we're going to get. Andrew, can you see it at all?
Not really.
Not really. So there is the track. There are the back pads. 1, 2, 3. And the front toes. Heading due south into Hoffman's, I think it's called. So that lion is not going to be viewed by us this morning. I'm sure it will come back at some stage, but not this morning. So we're going to go back up Twin Dams, find where the leopard tracks left the road, and then carry on from there. I'm just going to tell Brent that this lion's going south. Brent, tracks of this male lion was following have gone south across the border, Twin Dams. Beautiful morning. Okay, copy. Do you want me to check anywhere? I shouldn't just carry on. Copy, I'll check the rest of the southern boundary. What we're going to do is just check along the southern boundary here, just to check if the ones that Brent is following haven't crossed south as well. At the moment they haven't, and they've turned from going south towards the Treehouse Dam, which is quite nice. Yeah. Perchance we will be lucky, well, one of us will, and therefore you will. Beautiful morning. There are robins calling. The the mist isn't sort of lifting very enthusiastically, and we certainly haven't seen the sun yet. And I suppose as we move towards summer and the springtime, so the air will start to become more laden with moisture. That doesn't mean, though, that it's going to rain necessarily. And as I've told a few of you before, well, I've told everybody, we have a sort of bet on as to when it's going to rain. And Brent and I both think it's going to rain in probably fairly late November. We have some eternal optimists who think September. That's Andrew, he's fist pumping. And there are others who think it will be October. I suspect November. And by rain, we don't mean the odd splatter. We mean a good, proper, decent storm. No tracks coming south yet. Now what's interesting, apparently, like I said to you, is that apparently one of those Birmingham boys, I think you are misting up a bit. Sorry about that. It suddenly got quite warm, and so the water is condensing on the chilly lens. Let's just check this road. Nothing coming across. So what's interesting is that in a coalition like these five, they're obviously not all brothers, they're different sizes, and they're different shapes in some respects, with different kinds of manes. And so that does mean that they won't necessarily stick together all the time. And they do seem to have a slightly older one. He was either being ostracized slightly, or he's choosing to spend more time on his own. And that's not unusual. Buffalo tracks, you can see. Buffalo walking across the road. They don't seem to be running with a great hurry. It's now getting very eerily misty. Hey? Wonderful. Lovely to find the lions walking out of the mist this morning. It suddenly got quite stickily warm, eh, Andrew? Mm. It's odd. The temperature's gone up by about 5 degrees. And it's got quite sort of sticky. That's Andrew's very special lens cloth, everyone. Impalas, have you seen any lions? Have you seen any lions? No? The weather report is telling us it's 17 degrees, but I don't think it's... It might be a little bit warmer than that, but it's very sticky, muddy. Feels like a sort of hot coastal day. I'm going to quickly talk to Tex on the radio.
Go ahead.
I'm
tags. We've got tracks of male leopard leaving the kill site, going south in twin bands, and then west along Treehouse. Brent's following up there. I'm checking the southern boundary. There are tracks of one male lion heading south across the boundary. Brent has tracks of the others also on Treehouse, and I'm just checking to see whether they cross south. They haven't as yet. I'm about to come to Shibambo. Yeah, if I'm doing Brent check, there is still some left, but there's nothing there. No, negative, nothing. So the hyenas, I don't know why, I think the hyenas will come back to that buffalo at various stages. Until that carcass is properly finished, but there'll be lots of vultures there too. No, negative, no one's checked that. So I've just given him an update. He said, did anyone check the hyena den? And the answer is no, not today. But we may go back there just now and have a quick look. So we've now come quite a long way to the west, and the tracks haven't come across south. So that is a very good sign, unless they've decided to head on to Arethusa to see if they can take that territory too, which of course used to be part of the Matimba territory. And just to the south of us yesterday, there were three male lions calling. Got Brent on the radio. Go, Brent. It says he can hear the lions. Okay, copy, I'll check. They've stopped calling now. We're going to drive quite quickly along. He says he reckons they're probably to the west of us here. Copy, I'm at a junction. Andre and Shibam now, and I'll keep it posted. Gotta see if the leopard hasn't crossed out. The leopard and the lion tracks are going in the same place. I don't see any leopard tracks here. Brent, no obvious tracks coming south of Shibam Junction. Right, so Brent reckon he heard the lions in there somewhere. So we're just going to keep going. It sounds like they're still on Djuma, which is very exciting. Brent, just go again with the position of where you think that audio came from. Here. Lions in the mist, we hope. Buffalo going back onto Djuma. Now that strange warmness is coming to the air again. I'm going to stop and have a listen, see if we can pick anything up. Can you hear the crested barbet calling? Just going to sit here for a little while and see if we can't hear something. All I can hear is the alarm clock bird, aka Kristen Babbitt. And a ring-necked dove. This is very interesting. Okay, let's go a little bit further along this road. It's wonderful that they're in this block somewhere here. Eerie, misty morning. Such a wonderful atmosphere out here. I guess it's almost mysterious. Hey, Andrew.
I'm loving it.
Let's go up to the next junction, then we're going to stop and we're going to listen again. Tracks of female leopard going up this road. That's very interesting. So, I think this is Sandile and Shadow. Young, a female leopard and a young male leopard tracks going up this road. I think they're from yesterday though. And the problem is there's so much going on that it's difficult to follow it all. So just in case a few of you didn't know, certainly yesterday apparently Shadow and Sandile did reunite. Whether she has stayed with him or not, I don't know. So Dr. Debbie, she did come and find Sandile. Don't know if she's given him anything to eat, and whether they're still together, I couldn't tell you. Right, we're going to stop and listen here for a while. Sound. Alright, let's go around. Just keep going around in the same direction. See what we can pick up. There are the leopard tracks. I think they've been driven over. Yeah, no, those are old. That's from yesterday. So Shadow and Sandile, and for those of you perhaps new, young male leopard, a year old, and his mother, Shadow, and they were seen yesterday around here, heading off that way. And he's been on, he was on his own for 7 days. I think she came to find him on the 8th day. Whether she has then left him again or not, I don't know. But this was the area in which little Sandile was sort of resident for about 7 days. Killing on his own. Also hashing quite a few kills. Bless you, Andrew. Drive a little bit faster, just in case they are sort of going, heading in a southerly direction towards the boundary. on foot in this block, following up there. And in case you're wondering, it's not a particularly dangerous activity if you know what you're doing. To be off on foot, tracking lions. Lions do see us as the apex predator, and so their natural reaction to us would be to run away if they did see us on foot. So as long as you're careful and you don't sort of surprise them unduly, then it's absolutely fine. And Brent is very good at tracking. Definitely no tracks coming out here. What's that? Not lions. So we're going to drive a little bit faster now. Let's see if we can't pick something up. Tracks of the young male leopard quarantined, three-year-old male leopard, also came into this area. I don't think that they're following each other. I think that was purely a matter of coincidence. Go ahead, Brent. So Brent is actually a little bit further to the east of where I thought he was, but following tracks of the male leopard. Alright, so Brent is now back on the vehicle, so let's go across to him and find out what he's been following. And I'll see you just a little bit later, hopefully with some good news.
Welcome back, everyone, and we've got not quite what we're looking for, but still a wonderful sighting to show you nonetheless. We're just going to get into position. So we've been following the tracks of young quarantine, and he's headed into the block behind us. And while we've been doing that, we've come across a nice herd of impala who are about to drink here at the treehouse waterhole. You can see how nervous they are as they approach the water. Not only nervous due to the fact there could be a leopard behind them, instinctively they're nervous that there could be a crocodile in this water. And look at those beautiful reflections in this very still morning. Waiting for one to start drinking and then the others will. One of the adult males is so jumpy. Well, when you're an animal like an impala, it pays to be a bit jumpy. Lots of different things are going to eat you. You can see the mist in the trees. Definitely not cold, but cool morning. I think this mist is going to burn off as the sun gets a bit higher. We're probably in for a scorcher of a Lofeld day. What this is also doing is giving us an opportunity to listen to see if anything else might have spotted that leopard we're tracking. And if we have a look at this little gentleman right here who's about to drink. There's a female and a young male drinking directly opposite us at the moment. And if we have a look at that young male's horns, they're very straight still. And in South Africa there's a wonderful Afrikaans description for these young male impala with their straight horns. And they're called penkop, which basically means pen head. Sorry guys, James is just calling me on the radio. James, you're to the south of Shibam, but in that general area, but I'd say almost due south of Shibam, there was lion audio. And there's a little female. That would have been a tiny baby at the beginning of this year. Like the pen cop or pen head, she's about the same age. Oh, and we've got some Nyala coming as well. A female and two young male Nyala. Oh, there's a female already here. She snuck in amongst the impala, and then we go to the left a bit, and there we go, and there you can see that a female Nyala is a bigger antelope than the impala. Hey guys, just on the radio with James. James, I'm still at Treehouse. There's a lot of general game drinking at the moment. You can see even the Nyala are also quite jumpy around the water's edge. Off that impala. He's decided he likes that spot to drink, and then Nyala can't. A little family group of Nyala minus the adult males. peaceful scene. It's so peaceful, I keep almost expecting a leopard to appear and break the silence. Animals will drink at any time of the day, but you do notice a sort of preference for drinking. And you very seldom find animals like zebra, for example, drinking this early in the morning. They normally drink a bit later once it gets a bit warmer. Nyala are moving off, but the impala are still fanning about. I think we're going to move on now. It has been quite fun sitting here at the waterhole with all the different, two different antelope species that have come down to drink. Unfortunately, we haven't heard any alarm calls or even contact calls from any of the major predators. While I was tracking, we did hear lions, but they did sound like they are that sit south of us. So I think we're going to follow suit with the nyalas and move off and see what else we can find. Got a really nice view of those impala, and we're going to try and get another view now to answer Jennifer from Toronto's question. Jennifer said she heard that when an impala female is pregnant, the metatarsal glands, or that black patch on their sort of ankles, gets larger, and she wants to know if I've ever heard that. Jennifer, I have never heard that. It's not to say it's impossible, but I would say it's very improbable. And it is a gland, so with pregnancy and certain things, it possibly does. Yes, larger, but I have never heard that before. We're going to see if we can find a female. I've got some of the last year's baby boys opposite us, but I'm sure a female might pop out into the open. Just seem to be behind the sickle bush at the moment. And yeah, Vim's got some. So what Jennifer's talking about, if we have a look there on the back legs, you see that dark patch? I don't imagine it getting bigger when they're pregnant, but as I said, I've never heard that before. Those dark patches on an impala's back legs are glands. And they're quite interesting glands. There's a couple of different theories, some of which I don't think make any sense whatsoever. So when an impala is chased by a predator and they kick out their back legs, that gland will secrete. And there's a couple of theories. One theory is it's to confuse whatever predator that is chasing it. I don't think that is true. And the more plausible explanation about those metatarsal glands is that once they have been chased by a predator, they release that gland secretes and releases a pheromone that enables the herd to rejoin and get back to each other. So if you get separated and be able to smell your way home, so to speak, to the rest of the herd, is the more plausible theory out of what the metatarsal gland's purpose is. Yeah, off. Let's carry on. the last tracks of the unquarantine head south into the block. Unfortunately, our southern boundary is very close there. So I'm going to head off in an opposite direction. Let's see if we can find anything on the northeastern side. I know James is checking the southern boundary at the moment, so if he finds tracks, he will let me know. Birmingham's have left that buffalo carcass. I haven't been there yet this morning, so I'm not sure how much meat is left. But if they have left a lot of meat, it's possible that they heard the Matimbas who were down to the south and they've decided to head down there to sort them out. We love these misty mornings. We spent some time with two antelope now, and now Za is wondering how many antelope species there are in the Kruger. Now, offhand, I'm not going to be able to tell you, but I can work it out. So let's have a stop and a think quickly. Well, speaking, there's another antelope species, but it's running and it's gone. It was a little steenbok. So let's think. How many antelope species in the Kruger? Well, we'll start with the two we've seen already. So that's Inyala and Impala. And let's go with the big one next. So we'll go with the big ones next. Wildebeest. Kudu. Vim. You want to throw in any time? Don't be scared. Sable. Roan. Eland. And I think out of the bigger species, waterbuck. Bushbuck. Think. Okay, I think we're done with sort of big ones. Now if we move to the little ones. Blue diker, which we don't get here, that's a very special species, around 10. Bush diker or common diker, which we see, so 11. Steenbok, 12. Graysbok, 13. And Klipspringer, 14. Suni, which is a very rare antelope in the Kruger, it only occurs in a very specific spot up right up in the north, so around 15. You think, am I forgetting someone obvious? Boom, anything of anyone?
Thank you.
So we're up to 15. Well, let's keep moving and we'll keep thinking. So we're up to 15. Did I say roan? I think I did. Roan antelope. Study it. So Impala, Inyala. Well, let's do it by family. That's probably the best way. So we'll start with the Truffle-Leggeds, with the spiral-horned antelope. So we've got Kudu, Inyala, Bushbuck, Eland. And then we'll go Dwarf Antelopes, Steenbok, Suni, Graysbok. Klipspringer. So we're on 8 there. And I'm trying to think. And then blue diker, common diker, 10. What are we going to say? Impala, 11. Waterbuck, 12. I did forget one. I remembered what it is now. And a cousin of the waterbuck, reedbuck, 13. Now, what are we missing again? And then the hippotragids, or the horse-like antelope, so sable and roan antelope. That puts us at 15. I'm sure we're missing one though. Guys, why don't you see how many antelope you can find for the Kruger and send your answers through to questions at WildEarthTV or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. But I'm pretty sure it's between 15 and 20, I think closer to 15. Oh, wildebeest, 16. Out of all those species, we see most of them regularly here on Djuma and Arethusa, except, oh, Suni. Did I say Suni? 17, maybe. So, except for blue duiker, Suni, sable, and roan antelope. And eland, we don't really see here either. Head back towards that cock, buffalo carcass. If the lions have left it, there might be an enterprising hyena or three that decide to take advantage of that. But who knows, there could still be a Birmingham lion close by. Chatting about antelopes, and we've discussed what antelopes we might find here and in the greater Kruger area. Beth is wondering, and do we get Thompson's gazelle here? Beth, unfortunately not. Thompson's, or Tommies as they are affectionately known, are very much an East African grassland species, and we do not get them here. The closest Thompson's gazelle to here is probably in Mikumi National Park in Tanzania. Sorry guys, Craig's just calling me on the radio. Go ahead, Craig. Standing by, Craig. Not yet, so tracks of at least three individuals head south on Twin Dams and Weaver's Nest respectively. Tracks crossed at Twin Dams, also tracks of that of quarantine also head south into the block off Treehouse Road. I'm heading back towards the towards the buffalo carcass to see if maybe some of the other animals are still there. At least one set of lion tracks, possibly more. James is in that area. I'm not going to go the way you would expect me, down across past the dam to where those lions are. I'm going to go check around from the little shortcut that goes past the Gallagher waterhole. Maybe the lions discovered that nice clean water. Maybe some of them went that way, so let's go have a look. And also give me a chance, because it's quite very close to the hyena then, to see if any tracks are heading that way. This doesn't seem to be lifting at all so far this morning. If we look across quarantine, it's still very, very misty.
thank you very much to Barry, Joe and Anne who did some research, and they say there are 21 antelope species in Kruger. Now I'm gonna have to think quite long and hard about what they possibly could be. We've got to, I think, 17, so we're missing 5. VM and I are gonna think very carefully about what the missing 5 could be. Ah, sesame. I think sesame naturally occurred in the north of Kruger. So we're on 18 now. So we're still missing a few. Red diaper might be one of them, but the thing is, for me, I feel like right on the edge of their range. I'll put red diaper in brackets at the moment. Yet to be confirmed, I'll have to check on my book on that one. What could we be missing here? And since we've been discussing antelopes in such depth, Chris from Oregon is wondering what makes an antelope? Ah, that is a very good question. Lion tracks, well spotted, Bim. So I think we're still going to go through and check the carcass and then we'll come back to these tracks. So, speaking of antelope, there's an antelope. One that doesn't normally sit too still for us. Little male common duiker, or Grimm's bush duiker is an old name for them. And you can see those, whoop, there you go. So don't sit still too often. And below its eyes you can see those pre-orbital glands. It's used for scent marking. Itchy ear. Off he goes. To the rate of knots. So all antelope, interestingly, are part of the bovid family, or bovididae, the name of the family, and they are all ruminants. So they will have 4 stomachs and they chew the cud. They'll bring food up from their stomachs and re-eat it. Now antelope are not, I'm sorry, antelope are not deers, and deer are not antelope. Deer belongs to a different family called Cervididae. And the main difference between antelope and deer is to do with the horn. Antelope all have, well, sometimes male and female, but other times just the males, have horns. And the horns are permanent. They are bone encased in keratin and they do not fall off, whereas deer's antlers are pure keratin and they fall off after the rutting season, so they are not a permanent fixture. And that is probably one of the major differences between deer and antelope. And I've got an interesting question for you guys. So how many deer species occur in Africa, and in what country do deer naturally occur in Africa? And you can send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Approaching the Gallagher waterhole now.
There's a comment from Gil about,
do Liechtenstein's hearts beast occur in the Kruger? They do not. They are Miombo or Brachystegia woodland special. So we don't get them naturally occurring in South Africa at all. The only naturally occurring hartebeest species in South Africa is the red hartebeest. Whoops, over a bump there. And the red hartebeest occurs in the far more arid west of South Africa. No lions here.
And tracks here, looks like more than one. Unfortunately, the ground here is quite difficult to show you the tracks, especially in this very dull light. But at least two here.
Maybe they snuck off for a drink this morning and have snuck back towards the carcass via a different route.
The leaky Land Cruiser, as VM calls it, has been on this route. So it's one of the other game drive vehicles has a very distinct track that VM and I have noticed that leaves a trail of what we think is possibly brake fluid or clutch fluid, and very regular little drops. And we can see where, we're not sure who it is yet, but we can see where they've been by their vehicle leaking on the road. As soon as we do find out who it is, we will tell them so they can fix it.
Following up on lines, we've got a very nice comment from Amy, who wants to know what happened to the pride of 13 lions from April. That's what got it fixed on Safari Live. Hello, mister. I can see there's some vultures, Amy.
I will tell you about those lions shortly. The interesting fact is there are vultures. There's a white-backed vulture ahead of me there. There's quite a lot of vultures off to the left as well. And a hooded vulture, a second species in the tree. But they are on, they're in the tree. And quite often that is a telltale sign that there's possibly a predator on the ground. The fact that they haven't descended to take advantage of the fact that the lion's left, so there could possibly be a lion there. So the fact that the vultures are in the trees is a good sign. We might be completely wrong, but let's go have a look. Sorry about that, Amy. I just happened to spot a carrion eater, or a couple of carrion eaters, and being in the trees. Makes me think that there possibly might be a lion around. But Amy, that big pride of lions that we saw in April, and in the mist, if I remember correctly, the one took a very big shining to Andrew, and it looked like it was thinking about making Andrew dinner or breakfast that morning. They're called the Tsalala Breakaway Pride or the Mangen Pride. And they generally, their territory is further to the west and south of us. They do occasionally come onto Arethusa, but very occasionally, so we don't see them that often. That would, which made that sighting so special.
And for me, what made that sighting so special is that is a pride, or a breakaway pride from a pride I used to watch regularly when I worked further south. Oh, that's what he thinks of us, so we're going to move on. So, from a pride we used to spend a lot of time with, James Aswell, called the Tsalala Pride, that lives around the Sand River. And at the time we were there, it was the smallest pride and sort of got chased around by a lot of other lions, and it's now become such a big pride that they had to split, which is incredible. There are vultures on the ground. Those vultures up in the trees obviously have got full gullets, and the hyenas here. Awesome. The hyenas still not approaching right at the carcass because it's probably worried that the lions have got there. Might still be around, but this is exactly what I was hoping for. An adventurous hyena. Doesn't want to come up to the carcass just in case there's a male lion around. Now, Liam, just come down. That is not something you see every day. Stop and to the left. So you can see the buffalo horns there. I just saw an oxpecker land on a dead buffalo. I'm going to try and move forward a little bit. And strangely enough, quite often the ticks will actually evacuate. There's a bunch. There we go. Now that is not something I think I've ever seen before. So once the animal is dead, the ticks will generally start moving away. But as we've seen, often oxpeckers will open the flesh or open wounds in buffalo and eat the blood. So maybe they're taking advantage of that here. But this is definitely a very interesting little bit of behavior that I definitely haven't seen before. Isn't that amazing? Where's the hyena gone? That's still there. Position ourselves. Probably the hyena is very nervous approaching this carcass because how's that going? Oh, and it's walking away from a pile of meat. There's the hyena disappearing there. And the one thing that scares the living daylights out of hyenas is male lions. I think they heard other lions last night, and that's why they departed. See, the eyes have been eaten out, and that would have been, there we go, by the vultures. But hyena is still obviously very worried that the male lions might be around. I can just see it disappearing into the distance. Should probably let the hyena know that the tracks went south. He's okay, they're quite far away. And there's a different vulture species now that VM has found. And that is a hooded vulture, the smallest of the vulture species we get here. I was hoping for a little bit more action around here, but unfortunately not. I definitely think as it warms up and more vultures come, we might get a
massive vultures on this carcass a little bit later. But in the meantime, we're going to head off and try to see exactly where those lion tracks that we saw around the Gallagher waterhole went. So we had at least tracks of two or three going south around Weaver's Nest, Twin Dams. And these are going more west, so we're going to loop around and see if we can see where they went that way.